controversy over a possible link between vasectomies and prostate cancer. We'll have a report today at noon on the Midday News.
Today, hot off the record dish from people who get stars to tell them all for a living. Inside scoops about some of the world's most intriguing celebrities, including Marlon Brando, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Nancy Reagan, Al Pacino, Liza Minnelli, and lots more. It's all coming right up here, an hour of dish, so stay right where you are, okay? Okay. From New York City, the city where strangers won't give you the time of day, but they will take your watch. And we have such a good show for you today. We're not going to bother with jokes, and we're not even going to do gossip, because the whole show is going to be dish. We're going to be talking with people who have spent their lives discovering the secrets of the most famous celebrities in the world. They are the celebrity interviewers, the celebrity ghostwriters, and the biographers of such people as Jack Nicholson, Barbara Streisand, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Nancy Reagan, Magic Johnson. It's going to be terrific. My first guest is an official correspondent for Primetime Live and a contributing editor of Vanity Fair. I've known her a long time. Please welcome Nancy Collins. How are you? Good. Great.
Oh, thank you.
I didn't look, and I'm in my like fat lady clothes.
No. That's the red and the pink will make
sure.
Feel good on air. Yeah.
I'm like in the over blouse. And how are you?
I'm great, thank you.
And you have been doing now Primetime Live.
Right, since last June.
Since last June, and Vanity Fair.
Yeah, I write and I do television.
So which way is it easier to interview?
Well, obviously when you're writing, I expect them to give me 5 or 6 hours when I write.
Right.
So we sit down, just the two of us, no press agents. It's very intimate. I've interviewed you, so you know the process, 3 times, actually.
Right.
I've interviewed Joan. A pleasure every time.
Yeah, right.
And I ask.
Nothing except as she gets to the age. Go ahead.
When you go off the television crew, first of all, I have 3 cameras. So right away, I come in with probably 8 people. And they come in and say, hello, where are your circuit breakers? And it doesn't make for intimacy. So my mission as a television interviewer is to create that intimacy and to make them forget about the cameras.
How do you do that so fast?
I think I've been doing it for a long time now, and I really rely on my instincts. First of all, I always lean forward. I never lean back. Because this way I get absolutely, you know, direct eyesight with them. But beyond that, I do a massive amount of research. And then I write out 100 questions before I go on, and I take them with me, and then I never refer to them after that. That's my security blanket.
Does that look familiar? Who has been, of all the people that you've interviewed, the most difficult interview? Doesn't mean mean, just that you couldn't break the wall, no matter how you tried.
Well, I always feel my job is to break the wall. And if there's a bad interviewer, it's the interviewer's fault. It is not the subject's fault.
You really think that?
I really feel that, because everybody can be interviewed well. You just have to have the patience, you have to have the intelligence to make it work. Sylvester Stallone is, if I never interview him again, I'll be a happy woman. You know?
Just so tough?
Well, I am used to narcissism in this business, but he takes the cake.
What did he do?
He really has such an elevated idea of himself. Plus, he makes it very hard to get to him.
Right.
At a certain point in your career, Joan, you know, if they say yes to the interview, they sit down, they do it, we're in business. This is not, I don't want to be their best friend.
Yeah. Whose best friend did you want to be? Because you've interviewed everybody. Who did you really like and almost think you'd like to be their friend afterwards?
Well, I ended up liking Jessica Lange a lot. I didn't know if I was going to. I interviewed her for the cover of Vanity Fair about a year and a half ago. And it was a very intimate interview. We all wanted to know about Sam Shepard and Baryshnikov, and she'd never really told that story. And I went up to Minnesota, and she was there with her 3 children, actually, on vacation. And I sat down with her, and we just talked for 2 days. And I came back with all the stories you wanted to hear about her romances.
What about things that you were shocked to get? Somebody told you Dustin Hoffman really told you things that you didn't
Dustin is a wonderful interviewer. Yeah. Have you ever interviewed him?
Darling man.
Yeah. Darling man, and so smart. That's the bonus of Dustin Hoffman. I did him for Primetime a couple months ago. And we had a 3.5-hour interview. We had 4 cameras in a hotel room in California. And it was really like a therapy session. He began to tell me about his mother and his relationship. If you want to know about a man, ask him about his mother. Always. You get so much information when you talk about families, but particularly mothers. And in his case, his mother was very flirtatious. She used to dress in very sexy clothes, and he actually told me that that he thought he probably was sexually attracted to her when he was a kid, and that had always kind of haunted him.
That's right.
He also told me about his first sexual experience. Now, when he was about 15 years old, and it's a long, protracted story, but you might ask, why did I ask that, or why did I want to know that?
I'll ask that question. Why did you ask that? Why did you want to know that? I was such a good interviewer.
Because everybody has a leitmotif in their life, and if you listen to a person talk long enough, you will understand what their leitmotif is. And in Dustin's case, it's sex. He loves to talk about sex. He's like a little boy, sort of joyous in the discussion of sex. And once I talked to him for, 20 minutes and understood that that is what had really motivated most of his life decisions. I mean, if you talk to most actors about why they went into the business, do you know what they tell you? They wanted to go to acting class because there were pretty girls there and they thought they'd get them into bed.
Very deep.
Yeah, very deep, very profound.
What about actresses? Are you a turn off because you're so attractive?
Oh, thank you.
But you come in, I can see where a man would want to sit and talk to you and really have a whole flirty thing going. But a lot of women, I think, would think, very good looking, who needs this?
Well, I've always gotten along really well with women. I guess because I had a close relationship with my mother.
Yeah.
So I know women. I understand women.
Yeah.
I think women will cut to the emotional quick much more quickly than men will.
Right.
Men, you have to dance around and do what I call their kind of institutional talk. Men have politics and sports so they can have a built-in vocabulary to talk to each other
right.
about their emotions. So you have to break through that and strip them down, emotionally strip them down in a sense. Nick Nolte, I just did Nolte a couple weeks ago for Primetime, and Nolte never really gives intimate interviews. And he was terrific. He was really willing to talk about, I think his wife wanted to kill him because he's on his third marriage, and at one point I said to him, he said, I don't know why I keep getting married. And I said, well, do you think you're going to, will this be your last marriage? And he said, I don't know.
Hi, dear, dinner's ready. who haven't you interviewed yet that you would like to? Is there anyone that you're really trying to get now?
Unfortunately, we're all after the same 4 people.
Yeah.
That's you wake up in the morning saying, who's Barbara booking, who's Joan booking?
Yeah.
I've always wanted to interview Meryl Streep. I think she's very intelligent. I think she's made some very interesting career choices. She's turned me down, though.
Why?
Because she says my questions are too personal.
Do you let them check over your questions?
Never.
Never.
Uh-uh. And no really good journalist does that.
What if somebody said you can get, I don't know who now. Well, it's happened. Hillary Clinton, but you have to give the questions in advance. Would you do the interview? There are a lot of people.
Well, Hillary Clinton, obviously, there's different ground rules there.
Roadkill Clinton. I always get the middle name. All right, that's a...
I think that probably... If she, I doubt if she'd set those rules. She's too savvy about that. And she can handle anything anyway. I would love to interview her, incidentally. That's a person I would love to. I'd love to interview him, too.
Yeah, oh, of course.
Because I think there's a lot more about his childhood that has not been discussed.
Last question, then we have to go to commercial. Do you get more out of the men because you flirt with them? Who tried to make you?
Joan, this is a professional situation.
You know, a lot happens, Nancy. A lot of eye contact while you're asking questions.
Yeah, but it stops there, doesn't it? I mean, this is business.
Did anyone try to ask you out?
Yes.
Can you
not during the course of the interview?
But afterwards.
No, but I can't kiss and tell.
How many, on the average, have asked you out?
I think. Actually, at the end of it, I'm more of a maternal figure to them than I am a sex object.
Have you ever gone out with anybody afterwards?
I'm friendly with a couple of them.
But that's not the same as... Have you ever,
No, I've never... In terms of movie stars, for instance, I'm not interested in movie stars as partners for my life. Because, it's not, as you know, they're not, their lives are not conducive to great friendships.
Right. Who have you stayed friendly with besides me?
Besides Joan Rivers?
Yeah.
One of my favorite interviews.
Yeah, but, well,
very few people you can go back to you, Jack Nicholson, I can go back again,
so
because he's very smart, his life keeps changing, he's totally honest. If people only understood, they have nothing to lose by telling the truth.
Yeah.
Particularly movie stars, because their life story is their currency. That, how are they going to spend it but with us, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Who would I like to go back to?
Yeah.
I could talk to Jack again. My idea of friendship with a movie star is that next time I ask for an interview, they say yes.
Okay, that's fair enough.
Uh-huh.
So you're going to stay out here.
Yes.
I'm going to keep bringing people out, and then we're going to talk in general. It's going to be terrific. When we come back, we're going to be joined by Playboy's premier interviewer, so please stay with us.
You must have gotten along very well with your mother. I mean, you must have liked her. Do you like her?
I liked her, but she bothered me. She flirted with my brother's friends, and I remember thinking, why couldn't I just have this great, big, fat Jewish mother who just stayed in the kitchen? She had this great figure, and she competed with us. And when I started college, she decided to go to college the same time as me. I used to see her on campus with a tight skirt and a sweater, I could see her kind of coming on.
That probably was sexually confusing for you, wasn't it?
It unnerved me. I don't know in what way. She might have turned me on a little bit. I'm sure that confused me.
This toilet may look clean, but under the rim are grungies ordinary cleaners can't always reach. But Toilet Duck can. It's the thick liquid toilet bowl cleaner that's preferred 3-to-1 over the leading brand. Toilet Duck's unique duck neck and thick, powerful formula reach up under the rim to leave your whole bowl clean and sanitary, right down to the grungies. Toilet Duck. Nothing fights dirt like duck. From S.C. Johnson Wax.
An hour into the job, the cough and burning fever kicked in. Kevin Ross has the flu, and that calls for serious medicine. Theraflu. Strong, hot liquid relief to ease flu symptoms fast. Theraflu. Your flu misery stops here.
Freshen your carpets with Glade Carpet Potpourri for pet odors. With the fresh potpourri scent you can only get from Glade. Glade Carpet Potpourri for pet odors.
No, and potpourri is like Glade.
When my son dropped out of school, I tried everything to make him go back.
She even made me call a psychic.
He called the American Psychic Association, where the country's most gifted psychics are waiting to help you.
The psychic said he would go places with a diploma.
I'm going to college. That psychic knows her stuff.
Call now and learn how the American Psychic Association can help you.
Call 1-800-538-8877. Must be over 18.
With PMS, even little things set me off.
I get bad headaches.
And I feel bloated.
But Premsin helps a lot.
Premsin is, it's my weapon against PMS.
Premsin PMS, for the period before your period.
Arthritis, tendonitis, back pain. Cool it, heat it with Icy Hot. Icy to dull the pain, hot to relax it away. Fast-acting Icy Hot, icy and hot therapy for pain.
How old were you when your father told you that you better develop your body because you don't have much brains?
I was about 14. 13 or 14.
Are you ashamed of your father?
No, not at all.
Are you at odds with him now?
No, not at all. Not at odds. There's always been conflict, but I respect him, but I don't know exactly how to communicate with him yet.
Okay, we are talking with celebrity interviewers, the people who get to the stars and get them to talk. When people say they buy the Playboy magazine for the interview, it's usually an interview that my guest has written. He is the author of many books, including The Houstons and Conversations with Brando. Please welcome Lawrence Grobel. How nice to have you on. Okay. There was Stallone. Did you feel the way Nancy felt, that he was very egocentric?
Yeah, well, when I met Stallone, I don't know if you saw in the clip, but I'm wearing a kind of a T-shirt, and he's wearing very, very nice clothing, and his hair was perfectly coiffed. And It was a TV interview, which is a little different than a lot of the ones I do. But what happened there is that there was a sunscreen that was behind him that day. And when we returned to tape, one of the guys wasn't there to hold it, and the metal pole was coming down on his head. So we were sitting at a little bit of further than I was from you, and I had my mic on, he had his mic on, and I lunged for him because I was trying to stop this. And he went like this. He thought I was coming at him. I said, it's a perfect celebrity, you know, interview, yeah. Right? You're finally going to go and nail the guy.
Yeah.
And I caught this thing right before it hit him on the head. So I figured I saved him from injury.
Yeah. Did you get a major gift?
A major gift. Nothing.
Did
nothing.
A blonde
Didn't even call and say, I liked the interview, Larry, because I don't...
Do you expect people to call and say, I liked the interview?
I expect it, and I get it a quarter of the time.
Yeah, I never know if you should, because if they don't say something nice about you, then you wouldn't call. So I almost think, like... Well, you understand what I'm saying?
Well,
so I think it's professional
I've had it both ways. Because the Playboy interview is a different interview than most other interviews that I know of. I sometimes spend 9 months with a person. That's a long time. If they're not going to respond after that, that's, you kind of feel so bad about it.
What? You know? Seriously? Yeah. With the exception of perhaps Moses. Jesus Christ. I mean, who?
Oh, I got the one.
Who would you have to spend
Barbara Streisand.
Nine months to find
that
out
was the one.
Unhappy? I mean, it's like...
But she's not
Why
happy.
Nine months?
But it was, I was starting out in my career. It was the first Playboy interview that I was doing for them. She was the first star that ever appeared on the cover of the magazine.
Right.
And I made one agreement with her, because every time I saw her, she didn't trust me again. It was like
right.
this. And the only way I knew knew who she was she reminded me a little bit of my sister.
Right.
And so, you know, I felt I could deal with that. I lived with it for a long
right.
time. Except she was a tremendous perfectionist, a little
right.
bit more than my sister, Barbara. And so... I told her I wouldn't do this interview until we both agree that we're finished. Now, with any other star, I'd have been out of there in a day.
Right. 3 days, figure.
With Barbara, it was like, you know, I'll see you tomorrow, or then I'll come. I'm busy this week, you'll come next week. Then she went off and she would be doing a movie or making a record. I wouldn't see her for 2 months. I'd go back and see her again.
Yeah.
It wasn't every day for 9 months, but it was over 50 hours on tape, which is a lot of material.
Yeah, yeah. But at least, but I thought it wasn't like every day following
around. Not every day.
Like Boswell.
With Brando, I was every day.
For 10 days.
Yeah.
And you went
So I went to Tahiti, to his island, to do that one. That was a great assignment.
How did you get that luck? That's great.
Yeah. Well,
what
because
that?
That was about 10 years ago or so. Mm. And I did that after the Streisand one. Playboy saw how persistent I was. So when they got Brando to agree, they figured it might take a lot of persistence once again. So that's what happened. And when it took 17 months to get to him after initial contact.
And then the book came out.
Well, the book is out now. That's
right.
new. Yeah, because this is an updated... This is the whole interview. I only put in what Playboy had, but I always had this. I had so much material, and I had the whole time on his island, which I write about for the first time
yeah.
in here. And then I write about what happened afterwards and how we connected and stuff.
So. Did you like him?
I loved him.
Yeah.
I loved Marlon Brando.
He's my neighbor. I never meet him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
I hang around the elevator, but he goes right past my floor. De Niro. De Niro didn't like you, somebody
told
me.
Well, De Niro I spent seven different times with. I was at the Chateau Marmont in Los Angeles. I was in the Drake Hotel in New York. I went down to Tribeca. And every time we'd see each other, it would be for an hour and a half. And he'd look at his watch and say, I got to go. And I'd say, Bobby, we're just getting to know each other. It's just starting, you know. I got to go. He was like the white rabbit. And I kept saying to him, you know, I'm keeping my friends waiting, he'd say. I said, Bobby, everybody's going to wait for you. You don't have to leave. But it got to a point where I said to him, look, this is what the interview is going to be. Whatever is going to happen between us. If you're leaving all the time, I'm going to have to write that you're in and out all the time because it's driving me nuts.
Right.
And I did. So then I see him at a party some months later. And this interview comes out, and it's in the 30th anniversary issue, and it's a big deal, and all. And the whole thing is, I gotta go. Look at my watch. I'm asking him. So I saw him at a party, and I was bringing my wife over to meet him. And I said, Bob, I want you. And he looked at me, and he just said, you are a Judas. And I went, I was up for it, though. I said, you mean you didn't like the interview? So he says, you made me look like a so-and-so. And I said, no, I didn't make you look like anything. All I did was report what happened between
right.
us, which is what I told you I was doing the whole time. I love the interview. I think it's a strong interview because it shows a character. But you see, Brando and De Niro... Brando's reluctance is an articulate reluctance. So when he doesn't want to talk, he's playful, he's enjoyable to read, he's always got something to say. De Niro doesn't have as much to say. He keeps a lot more to himself. That's part of the mystery of his acting and the brilliance of it. But I don't think he's someone who should talk a lot to people like me.
Who did you find the easiest? Or who did you find to say, oh, shut up, cork it, I have enough?
I've never done that.
Well, I know you haven't done it, but in your head you go, here we go.
Right. But Dolly Parton was delightful to talk with and spend a long time with. Pacino I spent a lot of time with. Goldie Hawn I love talking to. John Huston I spent hundreds of hours with. I'm doing James Michener now and for a book, and I've spent hundreds and hundreds of hours with Michener. So I never told anyone to stop talking.
Did you ever walk out on somebody? Did you ever get that angry?
Yes, I have. I have.
Who?
Robert Mitchum.
Robert Mitchum. Why?
Well, Mitchum was, I was supposed to be doing a Playboy interview, and he's never done one. It was a tough thing to get to see him, and he finally calls in, says, come in, and I want to meet with you. So I said, fine. I go to the set of that championship season. We're sitting there. I'm waiting for him. Then I go to his dressing room, and he sits there, has a sandwich, doesn't offer anything, just, you know.
Doesn't offer you anything.
Nothing. And I said to him, well, when do you want to do this? He says, well, I don't know. And every time I'd say something, I'm making small talk, big talk, whatever I could say.
Right.
Finally, he goes, I just said, I'll make you this deal, Robert. If you talk with me and we don't like it, I'll take the tape out, give it to you, and I'm out of here. Just let's start it.
Right.
And he said, well, that's the problem. Just starting it, isn't it? And I just said, I'm just doing my job. I'm just here doing my job. What do you want? He says, well, that's what Eichmann said. I said, excuse me? He said, well, that's what Adolf Eichmann said. I said, are you comparing a Playboy interview to what Eichmann did to the Jews? And he says, the same thing, isn't it? And I said, I guess your publicist knows how to reach me. And I just got up and left. And I had explained that to Playboy because they really wanted him. And I was the wrong guy. And
Did they finally get one with him?
No, he's never done it. But ironically, 2 years later, I'm doing this book on John Huston, and Huston's told everybody to talk to me. And I write to him. And I don't tell him about this previous incident. And then I fell off a ladder. I broke my head, my arm, my eyes. I come out of the hospital. The very day I'm out of the hospital, I get a phone call, Robert Mitchum. I said, oh, Mr. Mitchum. He says, you get my letter? He says, yes. I said, that's why I'm calling. I said, well, will you see me? He says, that's why I'm calling. I said, well, listen, I just got out of the hospital. I got to, you know, but he says, it's okay, you can come tomorrow. Now, he's in Santa Barbara, and I'm down in Los Angeles. I got in my car. I drove with one hand, one eye. I don't know why I didn't get someone to drive me, but I did it by myself. I got there. He never said a word about my appearance. I walked into the door, and he just, like, you know, just looked, nodded at me. We sat down. We talked for 4 hours.
Did he offer you any food?
Never offered me anything. Not even a drink of water. And I remember I went to leave. I'm doing everything with my left hand. But he's a wonderful storyteller, and I got good stories from him. But it was a difficult
one. Lastly, before we go, there's one thing I want you to tell you about. Because you all get things from people that you don't expect to get. John Huston, you said you got something he never told anybody before.
Well, John Huston told me a lot of things he never told anybody before.
The
African Queen. Well, he ate human flesh.
He ate human flesh.
Yeah, one time he didn't know he was eating human flesh. But,
sure.
You know, and I have that on tape, and I don't know if you're going to run that or not, but that's one of the things.
That's what we're going to go out with that, okay?
Yeah.
And when we come back, we're going to be joined by a celebrity biographer, so stay with us.
Was it on The African Queen where you actually ate human flesh? Or?
Yeah.
And the person who fed you the flesh was taken away, I assume. How does it taste
well,
to be a cannibal?
I couldn't tell. It was all went into a pot. And this was before the company came out.
This is Berry Berry Kicks, a different kind of kid's cereal.
Mom, could we get that, please?
And you know what they'll do to get a kid's cereal.
I'll wash your car.
It's got a crisp corn crunch.
Okay, I'll never touch the stereo again.
Natural fruit flavors, real fruit juice, and less sugar than most kid's cereals. So when your kids say,
please,
you'll gladly say, okay, Berry Berry Kicks.
Glad I asked.
When you're congested, your nose takes over. You need Afrin. While cold tablets travel through your system, Afrin goes right to your nose. So it works 4 times faster than the leading cold tablet. Afrin, because you shouldn't have to wait to breathe.
Yoplait. Calcium-rich, active yogurt cultures. 99% fat-free. That's why Shonda Sawyer does it every day. Smooth, creamy Yoplait. Do it for you.
For free tickets, send a self-addressed stamped envelope to Tickets, The Joan Rivers Show, Columbus Circle Station, P.O. Box 20701, New York, New York, 10023, or call 212-975-5757.
They've traveled through dimension and space.
I come from the future, from a city that travels in time.
Waging a never-ending battle with a deadly alien life force.
Eat this.
Now, they must voyage back to the past.
Every man, woman, and child must be killed.
To save the future for all mankind. Carrie Fisher and Dean Stockwell, The Time Guardian.
Tonight at 7 on Channel 9.
I was up for a big job. The wait was nerve-wracking. That's when I called the psychic.
She called the American Psychic Association, where the country's most gifted psychics are waiting to help you.
The psychic saw me behind a big desk. I got the job the next week. The wait was easy, thanks to the psychic.
Call now and learn how the American Psychic Association can help you.
Call 1-800-621-6655. Must be over 18.
The doctor said to use hydrocortisone cream for my itch.
Try Preparation H hydrocortisone cream to effectively relieve problem itch.
It worked great, and I didn't need a prescription.
Preparation H hydrocortisone cream. Prescription strength without a prescription.
Every second of an asthma attack can feel like an eternity. That's why there's Primatene Mist. Primatene opens clogged breathing tubes fast when speed counts. Primatene Mist. Fastest type asthma relief without a prescription.
We are talking with the people who get the stars to talk. My next guest has been on every side of the celebrity profile. She's interviewed everyone from Laurence Olivier to Robert Maxwell. She's ghostwritten a biography for Zsa Zsa Gabor. We'll talk about that. And she has written now an unauthorized biography, several of them, as a matter of fact, one on Arnold Schwarzenegger. Her latest is on Liza Minnelli. Please welcome Wendy Lee. How nice to have you on.
Very glad to be here.
Okay. Authorized versus unauthorized. Unauthorized obviously means you go out, the person doesn't give permission. Authorized means the person is...
I see it differently, yeah. Joan. To me, authorized is publicity. Unauthorized is journalism. Right. We never heard of authorized or unauthorized years ago. We had biography, which was about a subject, and autobiography, which was by the subject.
Right.
And having done both, I can tell you there's a marked difference.
Oh, of course.
You know, if I were doing a book, I'd want it to be an autobiography, because autobiography essentially is publicity, and you control what comes out. Biography is closer to truth.
What about which pays more? Authorized or
depends. Well, authorized is much cheaper to do, because of course the subject is with you. You stay with the subject, as I did with Zsa Zsa. Unauthorized, you travel all over the world, you wine and dine people, you do a lot of investigating, and you gamble a lot.
Right.
I actually think that unauthorized, I hate the phrase, but I'll use it just for the sake of it, is much more challenging. It's much more, you build a mosaic, you try and build a picture of people's life.
What about the unauthorized ones you've done? What happens if you say, like we just talked about, you said you like Liza very much. You came out, I asked her during commercial, did you end up liking Liza? She said, yes, I ended up liking it very much. What would you, suddenly, if you had found off something really just awful about Liza Minnelli, would you put it in?
Well, I did. I mean, the thing is, I think...
What'd you find?
Well, I'll get to that in a minute.
Okay.
But the thing is this, that I don't think any biographer worth their salt does a book unless they really like the subject. I mean, my biography of Arnold Schwarzenegger was very controversial, but I like Arnold on many levels. I don't always approve of him, but that's something else. But you have to like a subject because you devote 2 years of your life and a considerable amount of effort. I mean, you live with these people, you sleep with them, you dream of them.
Right.
I used to wake my husband up at night and say, He's in the room. Arnold's here. You know, and
you
really...
And you get out. You
well, you become these people almost. They devour you. So you can't do that if you don't like the person. So I liked Liza and I liked Arnold. I did find out one or two things that were a bit negative about Liza's sex life. I had an eyewitness on tape, a very credible source who saw Liza in bed with someone. And
is it in the book?
No, I chose to leave it out of the book. I actually opted for what I consider to be bad journalism, but there's such a backlash these days against biographers. People think we dig dirt. And when you find truth...
Let's go back. You know something very scandalous about Liza that you chose not to put in.
Right.
As your editor, I would say to you, this must go in the book. Isn't that what's going to sell the book? Isn't that what's going to say, my God, buy the book, but you find out who Liza was sleeping with?
I just don't think one needs to go the tabloid route. I mean, tabloid journalism's great, and it's doing very well out there, but this is someone's life, and this would have destroyed her career.
Oh, no, then... Will you tell me later during break? And then I bet Liza will be on the show whenever I call her.
Well, I must say this, Liza hasn't yet sent me flowers or been grateful. You know, the problem is that in today's society, everybody buys the tabloids, everybody wants to know the gossip, but there's a tremendous dislike of people who go out there and look for the truth. It is far easier to be an authorized biographer to write somebody's book, to do a puff piece, but it's not journalism.
Now tell me about Zsa Zsa Gabor, you ghost.
Well, what happened with Zsa Zsa?
How did that happen? Well, what's there to tell?
When I was a very young journalist at the BBC, I went to interview Zsa Zsa for a BBC radio program. She kept me waiting for 6 hours, which I didn't mind. It was worth waiting for. At the end of which, her Zsa Zsa turned to me and said, "Sweetheart, darling, you're so quick. You must come to Hollywood and I will help you." So on Zsa Zsa's invitation, I came to Los Angeles with $400, no work permit. I couldn't drive. And imagine that I was going to be on television and be a star. Well, it didn't happen because the man who Zsa Zsa said would manage me turned out to be a secretary, but Zsa Zsa herself was very kind to me. Flash forward 15 years, I got a call from someone saying, Zsa Zsa needs a ghost. She's had 4 of them. Would you be the 5th? 4 people had tried to write her book and failed. So without skipping a beat, I said yes. My agent said don't do it. Her agent said don't do it. But I felt I had to do it because without Zsa Zsa, I would never have come to America, and I love being in America, so that's why I did it. Zsa Zsa was incredible. Zsa Zsa was very truthful. She told me amazing things. We got on very well. Zsa Zsa actually likes women, I think, a lot better than men. She revealed details of the affair with Frank Sinatra. What was wonderful about it, actually, was that Zsa Zsa knew that, having chosen me, that I was a professional. She didn't touch the text. She just let me go with it. And she was...
That's interesting. I'm interrupting you. Who went through the text?
Well, I've never actually done another authorized biography. Right. But no, Zsa Zsa just let it alone. I said to Zsa Zsa, we cannot overplay this prison thing. After all, it was not the Dreyfus trials.
No.
You know, the people out there starving, you know. And she went with it. And one of the great things about Zsa Zsa is that she's got a terrific sense of humor.
Yes, I found that too.
Well, she was crying at one point, telling me about Porfira Rubirosa, her first great, one of her great loves, one of her many great loves. And she told me about when Rubirosa died. And I was in tears, and she was in tears. And she said, darling, he died in spring in a car crash. He was driving a red Ferrari through the Bois de Boulogne in Paris, and all of a sudden there was a car crash, and the Ferrari crashed, and Ruby was dead. And his last words, they told me, was Zsa Zsa. I love only Zsa Zsa. And I said, Zsa Zsa, how incredible. Yes, I don't believe it. He was thinking of his life. He wasn't thinking of me. He was dying. You know, so she's got a great sense of reality amid all the flair and all the fluffiness.
All the people that you have dealt with or written about, who did you like the most, who did you like the least? And that's not saying they're not nice, but...
Joan, it's an interesting question. The trouble is, I've been a journalist for 21 years now, and I've worked for the BBC, I work for the Sunday Times, Sunday Express, everything. Everybody always says, who did you like?
Yeah.
I think it's deceptive. I don't think that anyone on interviews does anything other than project likability. They're all likable because it's their profession to be like. Being a star is being able to project oneself in a likable way. And I think one would be a very self-deluded journalist to believe that the person one saw, no matter how long one spent with them, was a real, true person, because you're seeing an actor, and an actor knows how to act likability. And so I would hate to say it, who did I enjoy being with? I love being with Bianca Jagger. I spent 6 hours with her afterwards I found out she'd lied about her age.
But big deal about that.
Yes, okay. No, but still, you sort of feel you're getting close to someone, and you're not. It's an illusion.
Well,
you're there to represent
the... One little lie about your age.
You're there, Joan. Joan, I mean, I have an old-fashioned idea of journalism. I think a journalist is there not to be a friend.
Yeah, but not your age.
Okay. But I truly think the journalist is there.
Oh, shut up. I like you very much, but you'll pull these fingernails out before you get my A.
Joan, but you're interviewing me.
I know.
No, but I mean, I think that truly the journalist is there to represent the public, to ask the questions the public would like answered,
right.
You know, asked. But I enjoyed spending time with a lot of them. I was attracted to a lot of them, the men, I mean, you know.
Yeah.
And that, of course, is one of the perks of being a journalist, but one of the ambiguities, because one can delude oneself into thinking one's on their level. One never is.
Yeah, that's very smart, very perceptive. And we will come back. We're going to be joined by a ghostwriter to the stars, and then we're all going to talk in general. But we're not going to find out anybody's age. So stay tuned.
Never get that room picked up or the stereo turned down, but at least you can get those whites completely clean with new Ultra Surf Plus Bleaching Action. Its bleaching action out whitens ordinary detergents and removes odors entirely for a complete white, so you can be proud of how your family looks, even when you hope no one's looking. New Ultra Surf Plus Bleaching Action, the complete white.
What do these breath mints have that Tic Tacs don't? More zip? bath. More pleasure? Uh-uh. Oh, I remember. More calories. I knew there was something.
Big odors lurk in small places.
Stick it to our stick-ups.
Big odors linger in small places.
Stick it to our stick-ups.
Concentrated Airwick stick-ups stop big odors in small places. Airwick stick-ups.
Stick it to our...
You're approved, or we'll pay you $100 cash. If you have a checking account, you're approved with the Century Gold Card with a credit line up to $5,000.
I use my Century Gold Card for new furniture, electronics, and photography gear.
And I use my Century Gold Card for china, fine jewelry, and appliances.
Call now, 1-800-959-9000, to get your Century Gold Card with a credit line up to $5,000. You're approved, or we'll pay you $100 cash. 1-800-959-9000. Call now.
Do you ever feel like your life is spinning out of control? You can learn how to take control of your future. Just call the Live Psychic Line now. Psychic advisors are waiting to speak with you live and help you find the answers to a better life. Is there romance in your future? Success? Or money? Call anytime, 24 hours a day. Call now.
Call toll free, 1-800-526-2323.
Talking with the people who get the stars to talk. My next guest has listened to the intimate secrets of Nancy Reagan, Oliver North, Lee Iacocca, and Magic Johnson. No, he is not their therapist. He is their ghostwriter. He has collaborated with these and many other celebrities to turn their lives into bestsellers. Please welcome a gentleman with a new book called My Life, Irvin Magic Johnson. Please welcome William Novak. Was a major runaway success, wasn't it?
Yes.
And that was with
Lee Iacocca.
How did you get to it? And my God, did you realize it was going to happen?
I had no idea. I got a phone call from Nessa Rappaport, a friend of mine at Bantam Books, said, "Would you like to collaborate with a prominent businessman?" So I knew who it was. It had to be Armand Hammer, the only guy I had ever heard of, right? A month later, she says, "It's Lee Iacocca. Are you interested?" I didn't really know who he was, but I said, "My type of guy, gotta go. Let's do it." And it happened.
Did you get a piece of it?
I did not get a piece of this one, unfortunately. Yeah, I got a flat fee for that one.
A flat fee?
The first one, yeah.
Yeah, it's always that way, right?
Isn't it?
Now, who else? When you are there, again, when you're their ghostwriter, which is much more, or their collaborator, you know, with...
My name's on the cover.
Your name's on the cover. But nobody looks for that name. Do you know what I'm saying? How does it feel when you've written, like, the Lee Iacocca book and Lee is on a panel instead of you?
People always ask me that. You know, I used to write my own books.
Question.
No, it's a good question. I used to write my own books. I was never on the Joan Rivers show.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I get much more attention and ego gratification for doing this kind of work.
What if they tell you something like, again, they break down and they tell you things. What do you put in the book?
Well, this is a book I do with them. This is their book as they want to present themselves. So everything I do, they have the right to read and review. Some do it more than others. But they rarely break down. I mean, these people, as your other guests were saying, they're used to talking to journalists. And even though I don't act as a journalist, they see me in that light. They don't tell me the most intimate secrets. They never call me the next day and said, "Remember what I told you yesterday? Forget it." That doesn't happen.
All right, what about the length of time when you're writing a book with somebody? This can be forever. I mean, this can be my books, and I wrote them literally with Richard Merriman, but we really both wrote them in longhand and compared.
Really?
But it took 2 and 3 years. How long do your books take?
These take a year to 2 years.
Yeah.
Magic Johnson was the quickest because he's the youngest person I've worked with and does not have many decades to discuss.
Yeah, yeah.
But that took a year.
What was he like?
As warm, and the smile that you see publicly, I saw privately. Of all the men I've interviewed, he was the most emotionally articulate. And usually you have to really prod men to talk about their feelings. This man talks naturally about his feelings.
What about friendships again? The man that I've written all my books with, Richard Merriman, we ended up very, very good friends. Almost too good friends, you know, because I could turn to him and say, "See, it's happening again," and nobody else in the whole party knows what we're talking about. And In a way, it's weird, because he knows so much about you.
I expected to have a closer relationship. The first one was Iacocca, and it was very much a business arrangement. I thought I'd have to become the guy's son, move into his house, his best buddy. Other people I've been closer with, Nancy Reagan, Oliver North.
Did you like Nancy?
I did, and I didn't expect to.
I love Nancy. Isn't that funny?
Very bad press and media image. I didn't think I'd want to work with her. She never treated me badly. I found her warm and flirtatious in a way, and vulnerable and very real.
Yeah.
And we still speak every now and then.
Yeah. What did you think about when you saw the Kitty Kelly book?
I was disgusted. Yeah. I felt terrible for her.
Yeah.
This is not the Nancy Reagan I knew.
What about, of all the books you've written, can I ask you which was your favorite?
Oh, you know, it's like your friends. You know, one week it's one person, one week another. I had a great time with a woman known as, writing a book with a woman known as the Mayflower Madam here in New York.
Oh, what's her name?
Sydney Biddle Barrows.
Yeah,
I met her.
Did she show you all her things that she did? I mean, was
here. I met her, and I remember thinking, boy, if people think the car business was interesting, you know.
Yeah. What did you learn from her?
I learned that everything is about marketing. No matter what business you're in, it's about how to sell it, what to call it, how to present it.
Isn't that funny?
Very smart woman.
We will be back with much more in a moment, so please stay tuned. Is she smart?
I can't believe this report is due this afternoon. What is that?
Kraft Free Italian.
Do you carry Italian dressing in your purse?
Hey, I love Italian.
Obviously.
You want some?
No, thank you. No, it's too much fat.
Oh, no, this is Kraft Free. See, fat free, cholesterol free.
It sounds great.
Just try it.
Kraft Free Italian non-fat dressing. If it tastes too good to be fat free, it's Kraft Free.
Wonder if they make ranch.
Mm.
Well, they do. Mm-hmm.
Something more cuddly. Yeah. Bigger. Friendlier, maybe. Thank you. Not quite what we had in mind, yes.
Everyone wants to be the Cadbury Bunny, because only he brings Cadbury cream eggs with their delicious milk chocolate outside and creamy filling. While others may keep trying, there's only one Cadbury Bunny, and no bunny knows Easter better than him.
On the next Joan Rivers, inside the kinky world of fetish frenzy, meet a professional dominatrix and her submissive friend.
I hope you came by cab.
And the latest in fetish accessories.
My decorator has that in my living room.
Plus a fetish fashion fest for those who dare to wear.
Would you like to find the love you deserve? Is success in your future? Now you can find the answers and connect with someone so gifted, you'll feel good just talking with them. Call the live one-on-one psychic connection for your private reading anytime.
Call toll-free 1-800-972-6655.
Don't face your future alone. Call now.
Here's a scenario for you. It's your loved one's birthday, and you're looking for that special gift. That's a tough one, huh? Here's an idea. A night at the Sybaris. Individual swimming pool and whirlpool cottages built especially for you. How's that for a birthday present? Sybaris Pool Suites. It's not your usual cake and ice cream affair.
Call 708-298-5000 for a free brochure.
If you've been seriously injured in an accident, the law limits the time you have to take legal action. Now, if you delay, you could lose your right to receive payment for your injuries. Call the Injury Helpline. Talk to an attorney near you for free, one who will explain your legal rights and costs. There are no attorney fees unless you receive payment for your injuries. Time may be running out. The insurance companies have attorneys working hard on their side, and so should you. Call 1-800-252-1988.
Talking with four celebrity interviewers, the people who get the stars to talk. Who was the most demanding celebrity that any of you ever worked with? I don't even know what demanding time or demanding presence
I have to say, with me, Streisand was the one because I had to keep seeing her, keep going back to see her. And every time I thought we had enough, she. And then finally, when it was all over, she said to me, I said, is that I have one more thing. She says, Larry, with you, it's never enough. Right?
Yeah.
but that was, it was a demanding piece.
What about, you walk in their homes a lot of times, right? Whose home were you surprised at, either in the opulence or the good taste or the bad taste? Or
I was surprised that Tip O'Neill lived very modestly on a summer home in Cape Cod. No entourage, no luxuries, no protection, drives an old car, people honking at him to get off the road.
Right.
He's like one of the most powerful men in the Western world. That surprised me. And I liked it.
The first time I saw Al Pacino, I was in his apartment, and there was a couch, and he had a wicker chair, and I sat in the chair, and my behind went right through it, broke it. On the couch, there were yogurt cups, and the yogurt had mold in it, you know, like, and I said, I know this guy. These are like my friends, you know? It's like, so I lost any kind of intimidation about it, and I realized that I was just talking to her like a regular guy. There were cookies that were on the refrigerator, and I looked, and I said to him, what are all those half-eaten cookies doing there? He says, what? There's no... And I said, look, and we went and looked. He would bite into each one. He went to make me a cup of coffee and set fire to the dish rag, you know? And then yeah. we're hitting the fire out. So I figured that's a...
Elizabeth Taylor lives very modestly. Have you ever been to her house?
No, Elizabeth Taylor lives modestly?
Modestly. You'd be so surprised at this house. First of all, she walked in and bought it with the furniture intact about 3 years ago for a couple million. And so a lot of the furniture there is the furniture somebody else had. It's been sort of redone by a decorator. But it's really a one level, rant style number, I think, with a couple of bedrooms. She has a bedroom suite up, you know, a little bit off. But it's really incredibly unprepossessing. She does have some very good art, I think, from the Burton years.
he was very smart with that.
Yeah, yeah. Very, very. But other than that, it's incredibly modest.
Charlie Chaplin used to live in a very dingy, sad house by the shores of Lake Geneva, and his children lived very separately. And their great joy was to throw mud and stones at the tourists that would come to gawp at the Chaplin house. It's amazing how average celebrities really are when you really get down there. I remember Charlie Chaplin saying to me, as a child, this is a social thing, saying to me, I just love going to the Savoy because you get so many free peanuts with your drink. He was one of the wealthiest men in Hollywood.
In the world. Mm.
Hugh Hefner. He lives a life that's opulent what everyone, the dream is there.
I mean, he's got the dream.
Life. Yes, he does.
Who else lives the dream?
Magic Johnson. Every time I went to his house, and it was 30 or 40 times, I was excited going into this beautiful mansion overlooking the canyons of Beverly Hills.
Because I think it's funny. You got the dream living. George's
house was absolutely beautiful, but the day that I got there, the dogs were about to be defleed, and they hadn't yet been defleed, and this was my first day of interviews with her, and I was sort of saying, you have to be very polite the first day, excuse me, Zsa-Zsa, there are these black things over me. Darling, sweetheart, it's nothing. But Zsa-Zsa, I don't mean to disturb you, but I've got red marks on me. Darling, it's a rash, but Zsa-Zsa. So that was just one day. But, you know, one has to make allowances for celebrities, too.
But Brando is another one who lives in, like, a hut on the island in Tahiti. It's not like a big house or anything. I mean, I lived... He took me to his island, and when I got there, he carried my bags to this hut that I'm going to stay in. No mosquito netting. And then I look at where he's staying, it's not much better.
It's the same thing.
Really interesting.
We'll be back to find out more. And we come back to you, Nancy, okay? I also want to find out if any celebrity ever lied to you, if you ever caught him a lie, and what do you do? We'll be back with more in a moment. Stay tuned.
Freshen your carpets with Glade Carpet Potpourri for pet odors. With the fresh potpourri scent you can only get from Glade. Glade Carpet Potpourri for pet odors.
No potpourri is like Glade.
When I get a yeast infection, I want an effective cure at a reasonable price. So I switched from Gynalotrimin to Mycelec 7. Because Mycelec has the same full prescription strength medicine, and it costs a lot less. So now my choice, my cure, is Mycelec.
This toilet may look clean, but under the rim are grungies ordinary cleaners can't always reach. But Toilet Duck can. It's the thick liquid toilet bowl cleaner that's preferred 3-to-1 over the leading brand. Toilet Duck's unique duck neck and thick, powerful formula reach up under the rim to leave your whole bowl clean and sanitary, right down to the grungies. Toilet Duck, nothing fights dirt like duck. From S.C. Johnson Wax.
Here in Minnesota, we have a whole different way of looking at your vacation and helping you plan it.
The best way to start planning your getaway is with the Minnesota Explorer newspaper. It's free, and it's full of things to see and do, including numbers for our travel counselors and other people who can help you find the vacation you want. Call 1-800-228-3600 for the free Minnesota Explorer.
We are back, and we are talking with celebrity interviewers, the people who get the stars to talk. Lies. You're interviewing someone, and you catch them in a lie. Do you let it go? Do you keep going? What do?
Well, I think... I like to quote Pat Conroy, the writer, who said, "The truth is that which we choose to remember." So whatever they're telling you may be their idea of the truth. I actually caught Baryshnikov in a truth, not a lie, that he wanted to erase after the fact. I interviewed him 4 or 5 years ago. His mother died when he was 11 years old, and nobody had ever asked him in all the many interviews he'd ever done what happened to her. And so I said to him at this five, I think we were an hour into the interview, and I said, "Your mother died when you were 11. What happened?" He said, "Well, nervous condition, yada, yada." And finally, I said, I'm not understanding this. And then he looked away, and he's a very manipulative guy, you know this. But he was so vulnerable in this moment. And he said, "Well, she committed suicide." And he'd never talked about this before. And I was stunned by the answer because I wasn't expecting it. And I also realized how traumatic that was for an 11-year-old to do that. And then I went on and later on asked him how she did it. Now, why did I do that? Only because I think that the memory of how your parents died, both of my parents are dead, alas, stays with you forever. So I was interested in knowing what visualization he had vis-a-vis his mother's death. Now, when we decided, 3 weeks later, he calls me up, I'm on Dell, and he says, "Oh, by the way, I don't want that story in there." I said, "The rules of the game are you say off the record at that moment, that doesn't apply." Well, he caused so much trouble. He called the magazine, had the producer of the movie call the magazine. Finally, it did run. And now he talks about it all the time. It's part of the Baryshnikov legend.
Isn't that funny? And you're the one...
I get that a lot, though, where I had Anthony Hopkins just tell me something. I'm doing him for Playboy that's coming out next September, October. And suddenly he said something about what I asked about Brando and George C. Scott and winning the Oscars. I mean, not turning down the Oscars. And to Hopkins, being knighted wasn't as much as winning an Oscar. And that's an interesting thing to know, because
yes.
I would think being a knight would be a little higher, but not to him. But then when I asked him what he thought of them, he called them a name and went on and on. And we talked, and then a little bit he says, "Oh, you're not going to run that now. You're not going to say I said that about them, are you?" Now, he called them 3 or 4 names. So he asked for one particular one out. I said, "Well, I got the other two. Now it's my decision," because he didn't say off the record. It's a tough problem we have.
Yeah.
"I will go off the record if you tell me beforehand. I don't want to talk about this, but I'll tell you to explain." John Huston did that twice to me. And he explained to me the problem with Angelica's mother and what he had with her.
What was it?
No, I can't.
But he's dead now. It's all right.
Yeah, but Angelica's still alive.
Oh, but Angelica's alive.
Yeah.
Okay, so
I had I knew things about Angelica, John, Danny Huston, and Tony Huston, the two sons, that I did not, as you were saying, did not put in the book. I mean, when you delve so deeply sometimes and you get involved,
yeah.
You find out stories that I said, okay, this could be a bestseller if I put this in. This will get all the attention. But these people have lives to live.
Yeah.
They've let you into their lives for 3 or 4 years, and you know, is it absolutely necessary to understand it? If it is, then I
told John that she could commit.
Let's go to commercial, and we'll be back in a moment. We'll be back in a moment because we're going to go to commercial.
Because the meeting never ends when they say it will.
Introducing Minute Recipes.
Because practice always lasts just a few more minutes.
Recipes are recipes you make in 30 minutes or less.
Because the curtain goes up at 7:30 on the dot.
For delicious meals like stir-fried pepper steak.
Just look on the back of the box, because you can only get Recipes from Minute Rice.
Minute Recipes. Great meals for the time you have.
Have you had it up to here with frying? Shake and Bake makes crisp, juicy chicken your whole family will love. Why fry? Shake and Bake. Introducing Viennese Chocolate Cafe. Rich, creamy tasting coffee with a touch of luscious chocolate. So magical, it could inspire a waltz. New Viennese Chocolate Cafe.
Some of our guests stay at the beautiful Plaza Hotel overlooking Central Park.
Controversial? Probably. different? Absolutely. I know you're gonna dig No Bull. Every week with Phil Jackson, plus the hot shots and loose cannons of the NBA. Less bull, more bulls. It's the show they'll be talking about Monday morning, so you better be there Sunday night. No Bull with Phil Jackson. Sunday night at 10 on Channel 9.
You're approved, or we'll pay you $100 cash. If you have a checking account, you're approved with a Century Gold card with a credit line up to $5,000.
I use my Century Gold card for new furniture, electronics, and photography gear.
And I used my Century Gold card for china, fine jewelry, and appliances.
Call now, 1-800-959-9000, to get your Century Gold card with a credit line up to $5,000. You're approved, or we'll pay you $100 cash. 1-800-959-9000. Call now.
You're about to see a whole new side of Efferdent. Introducing two-layered Efferdent. The white side helps clean and deodorize with Arm & Hammer baking soda. The blue side also has more mint to provide more freshening power than ever before. Making this the best Efferdent ever. Introducing two-layered Efferdent. Clean, fresh dentures come out of the blue.
Select from Florida Gold, not from concentrate. It has that Florida squeeze taste like the oranges it comes from. Florida Gold Premium Select. It's the real stuff.
Promotional fees provided by
Jonelle presents salon-style sculptured nails. Easy to apply. Just stick it, buff it, gel it, set it. You'll love it. Gel nails from Jonelle. Jonelle's French Manicure. Quick and easy. White it and pink it. For smoother, whiter tips and healthier looking nails, treat yourself to a French manicure from Jonelle.
We are back talking with celebrity interviewers. Okay, Nancy said she never had... Guys went after her, but she never really had a romance with them. What about you? Do you have a big romance with somebody?
Not a big romance. I think it's really unethical for journalists to do it. But when very, very young, Omar Sharif wooed me. I had a very romantic dinner with him, which ended up being one of the most boring evenings of my life. Every few minutes, he kept saying, my darling, I adore you. Talked to everybody else at the dinner party, at the end of which, about the 12th, my darling, I adore you. I said, yes, but do you remember my name? And I don't think he did.
Very funny. Okay, all of you. Who have you met that you had one opinion of going in and another coming out?
I was sure that I knew who Oliver North was. He was a big, tough, mean, kind of robot-like military man, and I didn't want any part of it. But when I met him, I found a fun-loving, well-read, thoughtful, interesting guy. We had a great time every week when we spoke. We'd speak 6-7 hours.
Now, who would you all like to interview now, if you had one choice? You said...
Well, I said Meryl Streep, and of course Jacqueline Onassis, who will never speak, nor should she.
You think she'll ever speak? No, I don't think she should speak either.
No. The mystery should remain. She should be Garbo.
Yeah, well, we should get her drunk one night, you and I. Get her in a bar. Come on, Jackie. Give it. Well, I didn't really like Harry.
I would be interested in talking to Saddam Hussein or the Pope. Yeah. Maybe two people that I'd like to really spend some time with.
Yeah.
I'd like to talk to JFK Jr., America's Princess Diana.
Yeah.
The mystery glamour man of our time.
Yeah.
That's who I'm doing my next book on.
And Princess Diana also be great to really sit her and grill her.
I think she's smarter, don't you?
Charles also. Yeah.
And then, Charles.
Yeah. I think Charles is much maligned.
Yeah.
I've always wanted to talk to Paul McCartney. The only surviving...
Can't you get to him?
Available.
He's doing
a book. Thank you all.
He's doing a book.
Because we're going to close out. You were terrific. See you all tomorrow's show, Fetish Frenzies. Whoa! See you then.
Making a difference in somebody's life can be very simple.
Pick up the phone and tune in to the Easter Seal Telethon 93.
We all have the ability to make a difference.